I really appreciate everybody coming out today to visit about Medicaid. When I first went into the legislature, a couple of people in this audience would be very involved in it, but there wasn't a whole lot of discussion going on. And now we're starting to see a huge interest in the state of Kansas, and I really appreciate that. I unfortunately have to travel out of town, so I've got to meet a hard deadline after this, but wanted to walk through some of the major issues that we are facing in Kansas. That we are facing in Kansas, so with Medicaid. Medicaid is really at the heart of a state budget deficit. It's about $3.2 billion. And as a practicing physician, when I came into office with Governor Brownback, I had been dealing with Medicaid patients for a very long time. And in fact, we didn't even, in many instances, we wouldn't send the bill in because of the bureaucracy that was involved. But we were having, we wanted to make sure that they had good outcomes, particularly for disabled kids there. And so we looked around at what other states were doing as we came into office. And when we came into office in 2011, Kansas had a $500 million deficit after the largest tax increase in the history of the state. And we still had a $500 million deficit. Now, we could have done what most other states were doing at that time, and that was cut rates across the board, and Kansas had done that, or they could cut benefits, or you could cut off people. And Governor Brownback, in January of 2011 and during the transition, we had that discussion. And the simple answer would have been to just do an across-the-board rate cut in order to deal with that $500 million deficit. And the governor chose to do something different. And that was, he said, I'll give you 2 years to transform Medicaid and get us to a point. So the plan was to take a very long time to go and look at this program. And so we need to go and look at, you know, what the impacts of all of this, and ultimately, how do we turn this into a stronger program? Now, this coming December, there is a perfect storm. And you all know about the sequestration, the tax cuts, and all those issues that are up. But even if you take those things out of it, the Obama administration announced that they were planning to cut $52 billion out of Medicaid over the next several years. And so that means that Kansas, even if the Obama administration comes back to power, even if they solve all of the problems that come up in December with sequestration, we're going to have to deal with less Medicaid dollars. We've known that for a while, and now we can be in a strategic position to deal with it. But when we go and we looked at our Medicaid program, it's something that has grown over the last 45 years. It is a very fragmented program scattered across multiple agencies. It's siloed so that we weren't getting cross-cutting care. It was very monopolistic. It had internal conflicts all the time. And it's a program that just hadn't had overall reform. And so we're going to have to go and start looking at this. And part of that is looking at how do we get to health outcomes versus what the federal law is. And the federal law just says it's Title 19, you provide X number of services, all of these services here. And those don't necessarily lead to better health outcomes. So how do we start moving so that we're actually taking care of our patients overall? And it's going to be a very complex relationship. It includes state political leaders, federal leaders. The patients themselves are at the real center of it. We've got insurers and providers. And we're going to have to deal with those overall costs that we all face. So we looked at this as there are three main populations. Everybody seems to think of Medicaid as that first population. It's children and families and pregnant women that you kind of think of as general medical care, going to the hospital, going to your doctor, et cetera. And that is the largest number of people. But there are also two other major groups. One is aged. There are about 36,000 Kansans, and a very significant number of them are in nursing homes in a much higher percentage than in many other states. And then there are specifically those with significant physical, developmental, and mental disabilities. And that population is usually involved in Medicaid for decades. And they are people that consume a tremendous amount of resources. And most importantly, they are our most vulnerable citizens And those are the ones that we want to protect, that we want to get the best outcomes for. So when you go and you look at Medicaid as your basic education, what is it? And there is kind of a way to look at it. Well, you can look at it as the number of people that you serve, times what are the services that you provide, times what you pay for it, and then add a little bit overhead, and that is your Medicaid cost. And so most of the cuts overall have been to, let's change the number of people served, or the services provided, or what the payment outcome is. You can change the boxes ordinarily there, and we've done that. We have cut all of those things to the bone, and none of them result in a way that improves outcomes for people. So what you're going to have to do is you've got to change what's in between the boxes, the multipliers. When do these things apply? So when we go and we look at Kansas, even in the when the economy was booming in the last decade there, we were looking at an average annual growth of 7.5% overall year after year. And if you keep that up, you're certainly looking that by the end of this decade, you're well over $5 billion. Now, we started to break that down and look at the individual groups. Okay. Now, the most interesting one is the number of people that are involved are about 210,000 children and families. And you look at that, that's that middle set of columns. The expenses for that group has been pretty stable. Those for senior citizens, which is a much smaller group, just a few tens of thousands, we're actually spending about the same as we do on those 210,000 people. But that program has been very stable. What's happened is, over the years, we have ended up having to deal with a lot more very expensive disabilities. And I think that's an important place that we need to spend our resources on. And that's why we're going to have to look at that at these different groups, because they have different needs and different outcomes. And so the cost reality is that roughly about 25% of the population consumes 75% of the resources. Now, already, most Kansas Medicaid patients are in a managed care plan. Let me repeat that. Most Kansans were in a managed care plan under Medicaid. But it was old managed care. It was just this one-size-fits-none sort of program. Now, also, though, the cost reality is many people require long-term care. These are people that require 24-hour assistance that may be home care, their medical care, they may have some training programs, they may have a work experience, but all of those are things that are paid for under Medicaid. And most importantly, those are people that we're going to have to deal with for decades at a time. And their needs change. And as those needs change, things get hung up. And how do we take care of them in the long run? Now, most of these people don't have a whole lot of choices. They're stuck with one and at most two options in most of their instances under old Medicaid. And so it's those transitions that are very difficult. And under old Medicaid rules, those plans just really aren't designed for them. And in the end, no one was responsible for the patient. It is scattered across lots of different cabinet agencies, different organizations, and different funding profiles. Now, the impact on the state also is quite significant. There's a crowd-out effect. There's a cost issue. And if you go and you look at the red line, those top lines, that's what we're spending on Medicaid. Those are those human caseloads. And you see between 2010 and 2016 that it's going to consume more and more of the state dollars. And guess what? What you're seeing is you're seeing the compression on things like education, on transportation, and other areas. So when you look at budget issues, look no further than Medicaid. It is a significant cost driver for not only Kansas, but for every state across the United States. So how can we avoid this crowd-out effect? How can we get the services to those most vulnerable patients? And how do we keep the commitments to our other programs that we have under state government? So you got to look at it strategically. And I look at it the way Wayne Gretzky is. Why was Wayne Gretzky the great one? Why was he the world's greatest scorer? It was because he skated to where the puck was going to be, not to where it has been. And that's what Medicaid has been. We have been looking at where it has been, and we're just sitting there rather than looking dynamically at to where we want to be in the future. And so we have a lot of areas to improve in the state. We haven't had strategic control of Medicaid program. It was scattered across four different cabinet agencies. We never had a overall comprehensive look. And we didn't focus on patient outcomes overall. And so with all of this fragmentation going on, no one is accountable. And if there's one thing the Brownback and Colyer administration is, we embrace accountability. We want results, and we're going to fight for our patients. We were having difficulties finding bidders and providers. Under old Medicaid, we were lucky if we had one or two bidders for particular contracts that we had out there. And we were having, you know, a difficult way of getting people off of Medicaid. We had a program that was very difficult to manage. And so we're looking at that overall cost option, okay? And when we came in, these were our options. Cut provider payments across the board, which we did not want to do. That is not going to provide better outcomes. We could try to reduce enrollments, and there are some ways that you can do that. Some states have done that. Missouri cut 100,000 people off of their Medicaid programs a few years ago. Or you could try to just reduce services. And in Kansas, we did things like that. In a previous administration, they just decided in a budget crunch, we're just not going to pay for a heart transplant if you're over the age of 18. And you know what the result of that decision is. And so we felt that we didn't want to go down those roads, and let's go and have a transformative KanCare program. So we had a lot of principles that were there. One of them is very personal to me, and that is that we need to care for the whole person. We need to look at these as the whole Kansan, and what is the outcome? What is their life going to be like overall, and how can we improve that? Second is, we want to make sure that our safety net, and this is an essential safety net, that it is strong and it is stable and it is available for the long term. Under the current system, it wasn't. The next issue is, we've got to deal with the reality that even the Obama administration is going to have significant federal cuts in the Medicaid program. And we've got to be ready for those. And if you're not ready to do them and transform your program, you're left with those choices of rate cuts, cutting benefits, or cutting people. The next issue is, we need to make sure that this thing is economically rational. And I was trained as an economist, and one of the biggest problems in healthcare, and particularly in Medicaid, is that money doesn't follow individuals and it doesn't follow outcomes. We are paying for services, not for outcomes. We're certainly, I think all of the policymakers in this room are certainly willing to pay for outcomes. That's what we want. That's what taxpayers expect. And so we've got to redirect these things. But we also need to discourage dependency. How do you create an off-ramp from Medicaid? How do you encourage personal responsibility? And in the end, this is probably the most complicated program in state or federal government, so it isn't easy. And there's going to be a lot to do, and it isn't going to be something that just happens overnight. So we went around and we visited with stakeholders. We had over 1,800 people that showed up in stakeholders. We had hundreds of suggestions over the internet. We have spent 2 years conversing with a number of groups. And what everybody was telling us is, we want integrated whole person care. We want to look at that individual. We are trying to make sure that we're going to have improved health outcomes. The stakeholders are telling us, we want to improve and create paths to independence. We also need to bend that cost curve over time. We need to make sure that there are access models, that we can get access to the people that really need it. And we need to make sure that we're not going to go backwards in that wherever possible. And then finally, we need to make sure that we need to enhance our community-based services, the programs that we have that are closest to our patients. So we've got this really huge program. It's across a bunch of different cabinet agencies. It's very complex. It has to be strategically coherent. We didn't have control over Medicaid program. And I think Leonardo said it best. Simplicity is the ultimate sophistication. This is an extraordinarily complex program. Let's make it a little simpler and give people choices so that we can benefit from that simplicity. And so what we came up with was a comprehensive integrated care model that is based on the patient. Now, to do this, you have to deal with the federal government. And what we are asking for is what's called an 1115 waiver. We have been in negotiations with the federal government, and we believe that we remain on track for a January 1st launch, and that has been our goal all along. Eventually, what we'd like to do is we'd like to move this waiver to a situation where we have a global waiver, where we say, here are the outcomes that we are trying to achieve and that we apply Kansas solutions rather than Washington mandates for that. And we hope that we can be able to move to that global waiver over the next couple of years, and we have started the negotiation and the process to doing that. Part of that integrated care is that we have to include everybody. We have to include all populations and programs so that we have greater options. We have stability. We need to focus on our most complex and expensive patients. We need to transition, not just from this fee-for-service or just pay for whatever has happened, to something that starts having outcomes and starts looking at a price and quality relationship. We need to build on our existing structures. We're not going to throw the baby out with the bathwater. We want the health system that we have to work better and reform and get rid of conflicts of interest that are there. And then finally, we need to build some fraud prevention programs in this. Let's see how we fix it. Another aspect of this CARE program is we need to create an off-ramp from government dependency. One of the things that is very apparent in people with mental illness, developmental disabilities, and physical disabilities is that when they have a job, they live longer, they are healthier, and they have more personal satisfaction. And we've got to make sure that that's a part of this, because one of the things that happens is with people that have multiple disabilities, they get trapped in the program, because if they get a job, they lose all of their benefits all at once. And when you have that cliff effect, you're going to trap them there. And what we need to start looking at is how can we create an off-ramp for this that is a stable relationship and is most important for our patients. We need to create some systems that start rewarding prevention and outcomes and personal responsibility. Every year that I was in the legislature, we would consider a plan to do something, such as a dental benefit, because it would eventually lead to fewer infections and visits to the emergency room. The problem is, if you spend that money now, you didn't see the result for 4 or 5 years. And in our budget-conscious world, those programs just never made it there. And there was no reward for the state or the program or for the individual to participate in that. And so we've got to create some things that fix that price dynamic and align it with those outcomes and rewards. We need to start managing these programs better. And what we had to do is start coordinating all these programs together. And then finally, in the end, we do not want to have old Medicaid, which is essentially the same program that we had 10 years ago, only with a couple other things on it. We need a dynamic program that fits Kansans' needs and will grow and take pace so that the legislature, the federal government, the state government, and most importantly, our patients and providers have a program that it can reform and that we can deal with this over the long haul. We have to change government. We started out with 4 cabinet agencies dealing with Medicaid. We've actually eliminated entire cabinet agencies. We now have an integrated budget system, and that's very important. We mentioned before about the problem with senior citizens. One of the things that would happen is the budget for home health care was in one program, and the budget for nursing homes was in another. So they didn't have a coordinated budget, and so what happened was, to save money in the home health care program, they would cut there, and the result is, in a different program, you would end up having more people in nursing homes. The result is, Kansas has a much higher rate of people in nursing homes than most other states in our category. And that's certainly not good health care, it's certainly not what the individual wants, and it's also not it doesn't make as much economic sense. And then finally, we really need to have an integrated management, strategic control of our programs, where there is up and down responsibility all the way through. And that's what we're doing. So you end up with four big things. You end up with person-centered care coordination for our most complex patients. We have strategic responsibility, and we're making sure that is clear. We're going to start focusing on increased outcomes. And then by using the power of competition and choice, we can actually get better outcomes. So where are we today? At this point, we have signed contracts. We are in the implementation phase of this. We've engaged three statewide companies that will provide integrated services for 3 years, plus they have two additional option years. Unlike other states, Kansas negotiated no-out clause. They can't leave us high and dry under the contract period. So we're committed there. It gives us control over our budget. We know what that's going to be. We know who our providers are going to be, and we know how to manage them. The second thing was that all of these plans had different plan options, and many of them are providing special perks to their individual members that come and join them, depending on what their needs are. And as this rolls out, you're going to see different choices. The other thing that's going to happen is there is certainly a safety valve for Kansans. From when you receive your notification of when what plan you're in, and what we will try to do is assign you to a plan where you keep your doctor or your nursing home or your primary provider, and then you have 135 days, 4 months, in which you can actually move around there, and then on an annual basis, you can move around. So we're providing a lot of safety nets there. The next thing is we wrote in the contracts, there are no rate cuts to providers. There are no people cuts to save money, and there aren't any benefit cuts. And most importantly, you get to keep your main provider and doctor. And all of these companies were required to offer a contract to all of the providers that are current providers now at least the same rate that they were getting now. And I suspect that some of them are going to end up at a higher payment rate overall. So we're trying to allow people to keep their doctor. When we originally started looking at this, we estimated we would save about $830 billion. We've contracted for savings of at least $1 billion in savings for Kansas over the next 5 years. And then guess what we did? We added new things, okay? Through the power of competition, we were now able to add a basic dental benefit that didn't exist before. We start providing for bariatric services for obesity care in Kansas, and we make that an important thing. And remember those people that couldn't get a heart transplant? Well, now we at least are going to have the opportunity to do that and to give these people a head up. So in the end, we're going to have clear accountability. I have firm protections. They're in the contracts, they're in our data, they're in our outcomes. All of the contractors must maintain health information systems. They've got to work with CMS, all of these different groups. They have performance benchmarks. And they have advisory councils that they report to. We're going to have improved outcomes. The main foci of the contracts is that we have less reliance on institutional care. We decrease rehospitalizations, and we start manage things like diabetes, and we pay for results there. And we improve access to health services. We consolidate the financing so it's less complicated for it, and we start aligning the financing with patient outcomes so that it helps with their long-term care pieces. We better manage chronic conditions. And what we're doing is we're now going to reward people for preventive care that keeps people healthy. We're going to actually take that challenge up. They don't see the rewards for a couple of years, and so there is an incentive to make sure that these things work. And then just one more thing. I hated managed care. This is not managed care. This is an integrated care model, and we have a big stick, and that big stick is we're holding back $500 million over the next few years, and we're looking for results, for good outcomes, for good behavior, and they don't have an out clause. We have control, and this gets us in a place where we can start managing this in a way that can improve. And it also sets us up that we can continuously improve in the future, that we have a program that we can control, that we can grow from, and that we can take care of our needs overall. So I want to thank Taryn. I want to thank the Kansas Policy Institute. They have shown a huge amount of leadership and an explanation of some of the financial and other examples, and they're being very helpful for us to help manage these programs together and give us some ideas that help us in a comprehensive way that makes sure that patient-centered care for Kansas is best. Unfortunately, I have to head out of town, and I am late. I'm over my time limit. So thank you very much. Yeah.